everybody. The topic is Sodom and Gomorrah, and it's about the story. And the reason why I share this with you, something that would have happened perhaps around about 3,800 years ago, is that in the story, as so many Bible stories, you find an application for today which affects us. And the story of Sodom and Gomorrah has incredible meaning for us because of the eschatology, the last day events that the Bible predicts through the various prophets. And so I'd like to go through these stories and see if we can pick up more knowledge, understanding of the Lord our God. It really starts, the story there should be introduced by way of the fact that there was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. You remember Abram, he came from Ur of the Chaldean, he took with him his nephew, and they both prospered. They had their separate flocks, but they shared the same water holes and grazing, and there was strife and there was difficulty. And as that occurred, Abram the older, who was much older than Lot, he approached Lot, and this is what he said: "Please let there be no strife between you and me. If only people could do that more quickly." He says, "And between my herdsmen and your herdsmen," you know, when you have an argument, others must take sides, either compelled to or enticed to. It's no good. No wonder that Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers." Remember that. "For we are brethren." Well, they were uncle and nephew. But to him, to Abram, he was like a brother. And then Abram shows his wonderful character. He says, "Please, now we have to separate. Separate from me. If you take the left, I will go to the right. Or if you go to the right, I will go to the left." Now this is an amazing approach of the one to whom the land over there was promised, at least his posterity. And he allows the younger one to choose first. Do you get this? Did you get this, folks?
Yeah.
Okay, keep your attention level high, please. "And Lot lifted his eyes and he saw all the plain of Jordan, that it was watered everywhere." Now, if you've never been there, the Jordan Valley was extremely beautiful to look at. Not now. But it was absolutely incredible. In fact, the statement is this: like the garden of the Lord. Now, when we hear that expression, the garden of the Lord, what do we think of?
Eden.
Oh, the garden of Eden. In fact, it says here, like the land of Egypt, which used to be very beautiful as well, as you go towards Zoar. I'll mention Zoar later, which means little. They were standing there on the height, and they were overlooking the land. On the one hand, the mountains where they had been dwelling. On the other side, you had the Jordan Valley, beautifully green, well watered. It would seem logic to go there. But there is a but. There were some very wicked cities in the valley, and you would have to put up with that. Sodom, Gomorrah, there were a few more, Admah, Zoar, that's one of them, Zeboim. These all will be destroyed, as you will see. The land was so beautiful, but the inhabitants, they were a worry. Then Lot chose for himself and the plain of the Jordan, instead of letting Abram choose first and insisting upon it. He chose first. Can you see the difference between the two personalities? Can you see that? It's about, we studied the habits of the stewards this morning in the Sabbath school class. If you missed out. Interesting, important, very important. And Lot journeyed east, he went into the valley, so to speak. And they separated from another, and they were apart for many years. The distance is about 25 miles plus. I'm not saying they had no contact, of course. In fact, there was a contact, because five Mesopotamian kings, some years prior to what we're dealing with later on, as far as the destruction of Gomorrah is concerned and Sodom, there was a warfare between five Mesopotamian kings and these kings of Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham saved them. He helped them out. He saved them. And that enhanced the status of Lot, and that's why Abraham went after them. The status of Lot grew incredibly in the sight of the people of Sodom. And here we now will go a few chapters further. Abraham is 99. His wife is 10 years younger, 89. Then the Lord appeared to him by the terebinth trees of Mamre. That is near today's Hebron, a little bit southwest. As he was sitting in his tent door in the heat of the day. That means it was the hottest part of the day. That was lunchtime. And he probably just had lunch and he was sitting there. And very hot, because it gets very hot there. And he lifted his eyes and look. He saw suddenly, he was beholding three men that were standing by him. Three men. Where they came from, it doesn't say. He didn't know. But note the man Abram again. And he's following the customs, of course. When he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them. He ran towards them. It's the heat of the day. He's an old man. And he bowed himself to the ground. He's very courteous. He doesn't know who they are. He has no idea. Absolutely no idea. And he says, my lord, or my lords. Adoni is my lord, but in the Hebrew Bible, it's in the plural, Adonai, which really should mean my lords. Now, does he know who these visitors are? No, he doesn't. Adoni or Adonai is a common courtesy title in the way of English, sir. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay. If I have found favor in your sight, a typical Middle Eastern expression, do not pass by your servant. In other words, he's willing to serve them. And he says, oh, sorry, I'll go a bit too quick. I didn't put all that in. Do not pass on by your servant. He invites them in, wash their feet, prepares in a hurry the food. There is the fatted calf that has his last day. He directs Sarah to make cakes, and they sit there waiting in the cool of the shade, and he's looking after them. And when I read stories like that, I'd love to know what the conversation was. At this stage, he does not know who they are. This is important. But now it becomes extremely interesting. Then they said to him, well, one is the main speaker, where is Sarah, your wife? Now, you got to understand. Abram lives in tents because he doesn't own the land. It's promised to him through his posterity. These are visitors. So the woman, the wife, would be in around the tent. But they were normally out of sight, still tradition amongst the Bedouins. So the wives, they don't join the men. But you bet you she was behind a curtain,
listening,
as they do. To ask for her wife is not a traditional way of courtesy, but he does. But not more so intriguing, Sarah. Where did that stranger get that name from? Then it started to dawn on Abraham that this is not an ordinary stranger. In fact, you look at the rest of the text. Abram said, she's here in the tent. And then he said, you and I know already who is speaking here. I will certainly return to you according to the time of life. He is obviously referring to the 9 months pregnancy. And behold, Sarah, your wife, shall have a son. Now, you got to understand, they virtually had given up hope. The Lord had promised it 35 years ago, but he had one son. He had a son through Hagar, Ishmael, but not accepted by God. And so he says, Sarah, your wife, will have a son. Now, she is past childbearing age, and Abram he is passed it according to his wife as well. Have a look. Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I have grown old, like where she is now, shall I have pleasure, whether it's the physical intimacy or the pleasure of having the child, my Lord being also old of age. I love that text. My Lord. I could get used to that.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, it's not going to happen. I know that.
The end's coming.
Many names, but not that one. And the Lord said to Abram, the writer now reveals clearly who it is. Why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I surely bear a child since I am old? And he continues to talk. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? There's no doubt about who this person is. In human form, not incarnate, but in human form, adopted human form, veiled his glory. He's listening to the Lord, and he knows it. Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you according to the time of life. And then there is that little incident that Sarah comes out and she says, I did not laugh. Did she know by now who was talking? Yeah. Well, she was confused, cornered, she laughed. Not in a nasty way, but in a, that's not going to happen. But he said, yes, you did. And that was the end of that little episode. You don't lie to God. And so, the interesting thing is, it's announced, and it obviously, as we well know, it happened. It happened. And by the way, a few decades later, after Sarah has passed on, Abram actually, talk about the ability of God, Abram marries Keturah.
Yeah, more.
And he's got 6 more sons.
Yeah.
So there you are, guys. Don't give up. Is anything too hard for the Lord? No, it isn't. And Sarah shall have a son. What was his name? Yitzchak. Do you know what it means? Laughter. That's what it means. They named him after the incident. Okay, so you know. Okay. Then a man rose from there. They're now getting up. And looked towards Sodom. They were going in the direction of Sodom. And Abram went with them. Not all the way to Sodom. In this society, if you have an honored guest, you accompany them a little on the way. Or a lot on the way if it's a very important visitor. And Abram walked a number of miles with them till he came to the reds where they could overlook the valley with the cities. That is the Jordan Valley. To send them on their way, this was a matter of courtesy extended to them. And then we get one of the most fascinating dialogues in the whole of the Bible. And you can learn a great deal from that. You should. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abram what I am doing? It reminds me of Amos. Will the Lord God do something without telling his servants, the prophets? He is now informing Abram his intent. Since Abram shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nation of the earth shall be blessed in him. Now that's a blessing that he pronounced of a covenant relationship that he proposed and cemented years ago. It's interesting. The same person is standing before him in human form and repeats what he has promised him as God. For I have known him. The word known, yada, always means either physical intimacy or it means closeness. Experiential closeness. And that is what we have here. For I have known him, Abram, in order that he might command his children and his household after him, that they keep the way of the Lord to do righteousness and justice. The Lord appreciates faithfulness. We must bear that in mind. But he said, because the outcry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very, very grave. The two words that you see here on the screen, the one on the left is Sodom. Sodom means burning in Hebrew. Amora, from which we get Gomorrah, Amora means submerged. And that tells you the story, what happened to those places, right? Okay. It's always good to look up those names. I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether as to the outcry against it that has come to me, and if not, I will know. I have a question for you. You're all awake? Did the Lord know what was happening in Sodom and Gomorrah? Yes or no?
Yes.
Oh, he absolutely knew. So why did he say to Abram, I'm going to go down, I'm going to investigate? There's no conflict here. He is meeting Abram in the understanding that he has. Do you understand this? And he allows this. The Lord already knows Sodom and Gomorrah are going to be destroyed. There will be a judgment. But this is like an investigative judgment, if you like. When God came down and he looked at the Tower of Babel, did he know what they were doing?
Yes,
he did. It is to let you know that God has judged investigatively what he's about to do, actually executionally. That's important. And so, then the men turned away from there and they went towards Sodom. And I want you to notice this. Abram stood before the Lord. He's not really blocking the way, but he's drawing close. The meaning in Hebrew is the same. Drawing close. And there's a reason for that. So the two others go off. But the Lord is busy with Abram. He seeks an audience. And then he says this. Would you also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Suppose there were 50 righteous men within the city.
Yeah.
Suppose. It's not impossible. I think Abram knew better, but we'll start off with 50. Would you also destroy the place and not spare it? He says, for the 50 righteous that were in it. And he goes on to say, for be it far from you, to do such a thing. This is a more mortal, a man speaking to God. But he's appealing, of course, he is appealing to the mercy and the justice of God. Both components. Far be it from you to do such a thing as this, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous should be as the wicked. He's saying they don't deserve that, the righteous. Far be it from you. Now there are two things here that are very important. It's not only because Lot and his family is there. Abram has shown in the past to willing to fight for the well-being of these people who would are at this stage so depraved and lawless and godless. You still gotta love them because the Lord did. Though he destroyed the place. Be it far from you. Now note this one. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right? Now to whom is given all the judgment?
Jesus.
He said that. All judgment is being given to the Son. The very person that he's talking to is the person that we know as Jesus of Nazareth. Do you understand this? I want you to see that. The God of the Old Testament, the Jesus of the Old Testament, is the same as the New Testament and today. If I find in Sodom 50 righteous within the city, then I will spare all the place of it for their sakes. You know, the wicked don't know how much they owe the righteous. And that, you can look at this world. This world maintains its existence by grace of the presence of the God-fearing people. Did you understand that? Very important principle. Indeed now. He knows 50 is too optimistic. I am but dust and ashes. I have taken it upon myself to speak to the Lord. He said, I've taken the liberty. He understands who he is and who that is. And that is good for your relationship with God. Know who you are and know who he is. And so he seeks permission. There's no presumption. No presumption at all. He said, suppose I was a little bit out, there weren't quite 50. Let's make it 45. Would you still destroy the city for the lack of if 5 were missing? And then the answer comes back, if I find there 45, I will not destroy it. And Abram now turns into an intercessor. That's what he's doing. And he said, well, 45, what if there was only 40, another 5 off? He's bargaining. And then the answer comes back, I will not do it for the sake of the 40. Now, Abram is a little bit encouraged here. He is perceiving, he is feeling the grace of God here. And he goes further. Now he doubles up, not by 5, by 10. Let not the Lord be angry. I will speak. Suppose 30 would be found there. And you know the reply. The Lord says, I will not do it for the 30 that are there. And then he comes back again. Indeed, now, I have taken it upon myself to speak to the Lord. Suppose 20 would be found there. And the answer come back. And this would have been a conversation you would have loved to have been present. I would have loved to. But for the sake of 20, let not the Lord be angry. He knows. He's trying, you would say, but he's trying his luck. He's not, he's pleading. But he knows he's hitting rock bottom. Might he have done his sums? There is Lot, there is Mrs. Lot. She was a local girl, no doubt, a Canaanite. That doesn't sound promising. They had daughters, how many? Well, there were 2 at home. There were others, they were married, they were somewhere else. He might have had sons. 10, surely. Surely, if Lot would have spent all those years in Sodom, you would think there would be 10 righteous people. Is that too much to ask for? I don't know. He probably didn't do any campaigns or preaching or door knocking, but I'm just saying, Lot is described, 2 Peter 2 describes him as a righteous man. And so he says, I will speak, but once more, just as well. I don't think he would have had more given in. Suppose 10 would be found. The answer is surprising. I will not destroy it for the sake of 10. Is God forbearing? Is God patient?
Yes.
If there's 10 righteous people, they might find another 10 and another 10 and another 10. So the Lord went his way as soon as he had finished speaking with Abram, and Abram returned to his place. Now the 2 angels, we're now talking about angels, not men, because they were obviously angels in human form. They come to Sodom in the evening. So they come in the evening, 25 miles walking, going down the valley to Sodom. That would have been roughly, slightly over 25 miles. So this would have been late evening. And Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. Sitting in the gate means you have an authority in that city. It is a place of rulership and determination of civil and criminal matters. And so he sits there, but not for the reason to judicate or to be a counselor, whatever his position might have been in that place. By the way, you got to understand that Lot pitched his stance towards Sodom when he separated from Abraham. But now we find him living in the city. You get this? The problem is this. If you're on a diet, don't go to a cake shop. Do you understand what I'm saying? And if you're struggling with alcohol, cross the other side of the road and then walk past the pub. And so Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. He was there for a different reason. And this reason becomes plain. He rose to meet them when he saw them, and he bowed himself with his face towards the ground, very much like Abraham. And then he said, "Hear now, my lords, please turn into your servant's house," very much the language of Abraham. That was custom. "And spend the night and wash your feet, and you may rise early and go on your way." This was meant. But it was often extended as a, what shall I say, a warm greeting. "Come up to my house, use everything you..." Of course you're not going to. They said no. Politely. No, we will spend the night in the open square. Now this is a test for Lot. He knows their safety is at stake. How much does he mean what he says? They're testing him. But he, Lot, insisted strongly. It's a double emphasis. He insisted strongly. And they turned into him and entered his house. Now, before they lay down, whatever time that was, very late in the evening, before they lay down, go to bed, go to sleep, the Sodom's depravity is demonstrated. "The man of the city, the man of Sodom, both old and young, and the people of every quarter surrounded the house." And why did they surround the house? Well, they called to Lot and said to him, "Where are the two men that came to you tonight? Bring them out here to us that we may know them." That's not an introduction, "What's your name?" and "My name is such." That is carnal knowledge, a homosexual carnal knowledge. That is what they were, that was their privity. That is what they were degraded to. So Lot went out to them through the doorway. Now Lot gets concerned. He has visitors. It is the custom to protect your visitors. It is a solemn duty. So he walks through his gate, opens the gate, stands on the other side of the gate, and he shuts the doorway behind him. So they can't get in. But now he has a problem. They take offense. This one came in here to stay. He was not native to that city. He keeps acting as a judge. He was sitting in the gate. We read that. And now we will deal worse with you, Lord, than with them. His life is now in danger. They will kill for appetite. Their gratification knows no boundaries as far as obtaining it is concerned. So they pressed hard against the man Lot, and now the story changes something dramatically. The men, the angels, reached out their hand, pulled Lot in the house with them. They shut the door, and then they struck the men who were at the doorway of the house with blindness, so small and great, so that they became very wary to find the door. You know, it's a bit like looking for your glasses, because you're not wearing your glasses. You just can't find it. I suffer sometimes from that, ask Fioli. No, I come to think of it, don't. I do. I put things and then... And it's staring at you. You ever had that?
Short-term memory.
It's getting older. Anyway, they struck them with... Not blindness, can't see anything, but blindness to find the door. Do you understand? That's the blindness. And then the angels turned to Lot. They said, "Have you got anybody else here? You know, son-in-law, your sons, your daughters, whomever you may have in the city, take them out of this place, take them out of this place, for we will destroy the city." That's their purpose. "We will destroy the city because the outcry against them has grown great before the face of the Lord." Lot believes them. He knows. That's who they are and what they are. He knows. He saw the supernatural like pulling them in and then striking them with blindness. And he's aware what's happening in the city. And that this calls for the judgment of God. And he is so aware. He's given opportunity. He is given opportunity to go around to friends and family to try to tell them to come with him. But folks, it's a little bit like you going there on Anzac Parade after we finish lunch. Have your lunch first. And you go out there and you're going to say to people, "Now God is going to destroy the world. You got to keep his commandments. You got to do this. You got to do that. And if you really keep it up, somebody makes a phone call, and then there's two men in white come out, and they will help you. Because that's how the world looks at it, don't they? Folks, isn't that true? It sure is true. The reception he had with his family was exactly just like that. They thought he was joking. And then they thought, he doesn't believe me either. They thought he was joking. They thought he had gone a little bit round the bend. That's what they thought. There's a three angels message in this story. Firstly, there's an investigative judgment. I will go down see, the Lord said. He's done it already. There is the account of the executional judgment. There is a judgment message in this story of Sodom and Gomorrah. There is an identification of wickedness, a licentiousness, which is crying out against God. Babylon is fallen, is fallen. We recognize that too from the book of Revelation. And there's another angel's message, that's too. And there's another angel's message. And the angel's message is very simple. Come out. And that's the story. See, only two daughters and his wives were willing to leave. And I'll come back to that. When the morning dawned, the angels urged Lot to hurry, saying, arise, take your wife, your two daughters that are here, lest you what? Become consumed in the punishment of the city. That is very much the third angel's message. Lest you receive of her plagues, the mark of the beast, the name of the beast, etc., the image of the beast. Do you remember we've studied this in the book of Revelation. The scenario is very similar. It's only local. Sodom and Gomorrah, the Jordan Valley. And by the way, when you go to the Jordan Valley, it's 1,500 feet below sea level. It's the lowest point on this planet. And when you go there, either side, that nothing is growing. You can go in the water, but don't forget to take a real good shower afterwards because you burn very fast. But this is about 20 times the salt contents of an ordinary ocean. Very oily. Nothing grows. Salt columns. Salt everywhere over the rocks. And you look at this place, if ever you go there and stand there, and then remember, as you see perhaps the bitumen coming up to the surface. How do you explain that as a natural phenomenon? You couldn't. The sulfur smell is very strong. It's all there. And it synchronizes with, and it affirms the story of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, who were located on the southern end where now the Dead Sea is. It's quite amazing. There have been excavations done, there were obviously settlements prior to the days of Abram. They have found nothing later, nothing grows in the water or near the water. The valley is barren. It's quite amazing. It's quite amazing. Nothing is really growing there. The Arabs call it Baralut, which means the Lake of Lot. That's what they call it. Arise, take your wife, your two daughters that are with you, lest you be consumed in the punishment of the city. Now notice, escape what? For your life. Have a look at this. Do not look behind you, nor stay anywhere in the plain. Escape to the mountains, lest you be destroyed. Now here is the amazing thing. Did you know that Lot bargained that as he left Sodom, that he would go to Zoar, that he might stay for a little while? It's only a little place. I'm so used to the... He didn't want to go to the mountain. He believed him. His life, the life of his wife, of his two daughters, could have been saved if he had not gone to Zoar. Now live is that. But he went to that little place which was later destroyed as well. He should have run for his life when the angel told him. He should have gone for it by way of example and for his own sake. He didn't. He was slow and he was a righteous man. It's just quite amazing. The attachment that we have to this life may yet kill us and prevent us to have eternal life. The sun had risen upon the earth when Lot entered Zoar, that's the little place. Then the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah. He absolutely, and if you, honestly, you go to this place, you can only try to imagine what foul place there. It's almost as if you can see it. And the eerie silence early in the morning. It's quite interesting. The sun had risen upon the earth when Lot entered Zoar. Then the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of heaven. It was God who did this. It is not something that he allowed Satan to do. The fire and brimstone came from where? God gave this great flood, of which the evidence is all around the globe. And God will destroy the lost also at his second coming. You need to understand that God has to do it. There is his justice that demands it, but his mercy is still open for us. To believe in a God who will not execute judgment is a grave error. A grave error. So he overthrew those cities at the plain, all the inhabitants of the city, and what grew on the ground, the evidence is there, and then we're almost there. But his wife looked back behind him. You know, he managed to take his wife out of Sodom, but not to get Sodom out of the wife. Do you understand what I'm saying? As Israel of old, you can take Israel out of Egypt, but to get Egypt out of Israel. You may come out of this world and join up this movement, but is the world out of you? Yeah. Folks, this is the message. She was lost. She was lost. Look at this. Look at this. And she became a pillar of salt. And there are lots of salt formations that could look like people, and everybody has a particular favorite. This one might be Mrs. Lot. And she became a pillar of salt. And this is the tragedy. It came to pass when God destroyed the cities of the plain that God remembered Abram. Why did he remember Abram? Abram prayed for that man. When the next morning Abram went to the ridge and he saw the smoke, and he knew that it had no 10 righteous in Sodom. He had prayed for Lot. This is wonderful. He had prayed for the nephew who so greedily got the first choice. And whatever Lot was hoping to get, he lost it all. I can understand Mrs. Lot. But that's the way it is. When it's time to come out, when it's time to get out of the city, you go. No matter what your possessions. And he sent Lot out of the midst of the overthrow. And here is the last slide. Likewise, Jesus said, as in the days of Lot. He says this in Luke 17. And he also said this in that same, the next verses. And remember Lot's wife. I know I'm not speaking to the unconverted. I know you believe it. But is there a bit of Lot's wife in you? Did you get rid of Sodom out of your mind and filled it with the Spirit of God? That's the question. So it will be in the day when the Lord, when the Son of Man is revealed. And so, what were the sins? Well, sexual immorality, you just look at the news. They're all at it. Violence. Never seen the world so violent. Materialism. In Ezekiel, God in his discourse through the prophet Ezekiel against Sodom and Gomorrah speaks against their indifference to the needy. We have sexual immorality, we have violence, we have materialism. It is culminating, and the posts of the norms are shifted, but not as far as the Word of God is concerned. They've always been in place. And so, we got to be mindful of this as He will come. And He's coming soon. And I hope and pray that you will be prepared for that day when He comes. Because come He will.
Thank you, Byron, for the message. Let's stand together and close our service today with hymn number 537, He Leadeth Me.
Father, as we bow our heads before You, we thank You that You are God. You're a beautiful, wonderful, loving, caring God. The extremes that You went through to save each and every one, the patience and Your forbearance have been so great. But as we near the end of this planet's history, and maybe even of our own lives, as we learn that it can happen so suddenly, Lord, help us to prepare ourselves today, not tomorrow, today. To make that conscious decision that Jesus is Lord. There is no other way. He is the truth, the life, and the resurrection. Lord, help us to choose this wisely. And then live forever to be with You in that incredible city that You have prepared for us. That is our prayer. So Lord, as we have fellowship and we have the bread, we have other good foods, and we thank you for the hands that prepared it. We live in a country of such abundance, and we should never take it for granted. Thank you for the food, and that may nourish our bodies. And as we go on our way home, give us traveling mercies, Lord. Bring us safely here again, safely in order to worship and praise you again. It is in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.